Can we talk about music? Or can music talk for itself? Let's find out. My name is Olga Jegunova, and this is Talking Music. Today, I'd like to explore Indian classical music. There are two main traditions of the Indian classical music: Carnatic music at the south of India and Hindustani music of the northern, eastern and central regions. Today I would like to talk about two particular aspects of Indian music. First of all, its identity through musical language, and second of all, its purpose, the calling and its philosophy. Throughout this episode I'll be talking to Freny Nina, an Indian classical musician, who has been the main inspiration for this episode. So Freny, tell me, what instrument are you playing?
So this is a sitar. This is the instrument that I began learning Indian classical music with. This is a string instrument, as you can see.
And we can hear.
And you can hear. And it's generally for Hindustani music. So mostly Hindustani music is played on the sitar. So it's traditionally a North Indian music.
What is interesting is that both our cultures are very different, but we also share something. And what we share is the seven notes, the foundation of music making. And in Western music, as you know from the first episode of this podcast, they're called do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si. And this is called a scale. And this scale on the piano sounds like this. Sitar, it sounds like this. But the names are slightly different. What are your notes called?
Sa, re, ga, ma, pa, da, ni.
In Western music, have this idea of intervals, which is the distance between one note and another note. So the very simple distance would be this, which is called do, re, and it makes a whole tone. The only thing that we can do about this is divide this tone in half and have a semi-step, and it becomes do, do dies, or do, re bemol. In any case, it's a semi-step. And if we divide our scale in a similar way, instead of seven notes, we will end up with 12 tones. But you guys have gone further than that. What I have learned is that you, within the scale, can go up to 22 tones. Because you can identify with your ear not only full tones and semitones, but you can do also quarter tones and 1/8 of a tone. It will be very difficult for our ear to hear these gradations between the intervals if we just take them out of the context.
Yeah.
And they will be better understood in the musical piece that in Indian classical music is called raga. So
yes.
Can you give us a bit of a feeling of these various gradations, please? So the transitions between one note to another are very, very smooth, because it's much more gradual than in Western music, when the interval can be, or here it's really the nearest ever note.
Yes.
And in between.
In between.
And we have yet to discover one of the most important words, I think, in the Indian classical music. We've just mentioned it already. It's called raga.
Raga.
So while preparing for the episode, of course, I made my research, and it's impossible to really identify what that means.
Yeah.
It's some kind of melody with improvisation, with freedom, with certain state of mind. How do you, as an Indian classical musician, identify this?
Because it's so, Indian classical music is so based on the voice, there's a lot of sliding and touching on certain frequencies in between the notes. And the main feature, technically, of a raga is understanding which frequencies belong to which raga. And there is no, you can't go to a book to refer to about it. So how do you know? So it's a very mysterious thing, actually. I don't even know if it makes sense. So basically, a raga, when you start learning to play a raga, you are given a set of notes. So there are it's like a scale, either a pentatonic or a six note scale, you know. So for example, this raga is called Yaman, and it has these notes in it. So the first defining feature of a raga, it has certain notes which are played in a certain order. So the notes are, so it has a sharp note, but you don't play it. You don't play the scale this way. You start with,
and who decides where you start? Who told you that you start like that?
My teacher.
And who told your teacher that he starts like that?
His teacher.
And here we go. So who is, where does it come from? And why don't you just write it down, and then we can all play from the same book?
Yeah, I mean, they have in South, in Carnatic music, it is written down. They have their system of notation has, you know, been quite prolific in the last few hundred years, because in the last few hundred years, people have started to write it down. And yes, there are some written compositions and stuff. They're just not published, and they're not, especially in the kind of music that I learn, which is Dhrupad, which is a further, I don't know what to call it, a genre maybe. It's a kind of a very ancient form of Hindustani music. So it goes back to the Vedic period. So the roots of this music, as we learn it, it goes back to the Vedas. And there's one Veda called the Sama Veda, which I haven't read. So I don't know what's in it, but it's said that that Veda contains the roots of this music. So it's passed down in an oral tradition for many, many, you know, thousands of years, hundreds of years. What they played, we don't know. We can't know. We'll never know. It's impossible to know. You know, I barely know what my teacher's playing. Like, forget about what they played thousands of years ago.
How many ragas can you play?
Maybe I can play three or four, kind of. To really play a raga properly, I think it just comes to you. It opens itself up.
What do you mean by that? It opens itself up. When I practice a Mozart sonata, for example, it will open itself up to me if I practice a certain amount of years.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about hours here, years. When I have reached a certain professional level, technical level, emotional level, and intellectual level to understand that. And for me, learning the Mozart sonata, it opens up in the process of playing that. Is it something similar in
exactly.
raga?
It's exactly the same. It's exactly the same. I mean, a raga could be like, they say the way it's explained to you, it's like, you know, that raga has a form and like a certain features, like a person, you know, it has certain kind of a form, and you are trying to feel for that form through playing it, through trying to understand and to keep to the certain frequencies that are required of it. And I think that when you hit the right ones, when it happens, then it opens up. You can hear it. You can hear the feeling of it and the essence of it. And it's not fixed. It's not completely fixed. So it can't be the same thing every time. Mm-hmm. It'll be the same sort of spirit, but it'll be different every time because it's always improvised.
But how much of raga is actually written down?
Well, just the basic scale, really.
So the one that you've just played.
Yes.
And the rest is improvised.
Improvised.
So show me what is fixed. What part of raga is fixed?
So it's fixed that in Yaman it will be.
This is fixed. And the rest is you
so,
and...
Yeah. So you have certain rules, which are your, you know, your rules, like mi, re, ga. And then, you know...
So what is that?
That is... So you have to... This is the movement of the raga.
Mi, re, ga is the three notes that are part of the raga.
Yeah.
So you base the whole raga on these three notes.
So this is the defining feature mm-hmm. of the raga. So when you hear this, you know it's Yaman.
I see. And Yaman is what?
It's the name of the raga.
Oh, then, and that it means something?
I don't really know. Some people say it means this mind, Yaman, but I don't know what it means. It's a name of the raga.
Interesting. Does it matter that we don't really know what that means? When we play a sonata, we need to know what sonata means.
Yes.
Or when we play a symphony, we need to know. But in classical music, sonata means... We also don't really know what. It gives you a shape.
Yeah.
It's a piece that consists of certain movements.
Yeah.
And has a certain tradition. But the content, the feeling is up to you.
I think sometimes the words get in the way. Because you're using words as like a flag to point you in a direction. But it's not the thing.
What is the thing?
I don't know how to describe it in words. It's something you feel. As soon as you put it in a word... It's changed already, you know? So I think that it's very difficult to put this in words. That's why it's hard to really define a raga. Sa, ni, re, ga, ga, re, sa.
Thank you, and till next time.